briefly tonight about the flooding that residents have succumbed to over the last storm yesterday.
Okay, thank you, sir. Councillor Bundy?
Thank you. I'd also like to add an item under new business about the Planning Advisory Review Committee's recommendations and what we can do as Essex Council to support their recommendations going forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, now we have the adoption of minutes, May 19th, regular council meeting.
Councillor Caxero, Deputy Mayor Malosh. Any questions? Councillor Caxero?
Point of order. Did we vote on that last motion for the adoption of the agenda?
Say no? Okay, all in favor? Motion carried. Thank you, sir.
I don't think so.
So now we've got Councillor Caxero moving and Deputy Mayor Malosh seconding for the regular council meeting. We just need an adoption.
Okay, any questions? All in favor of that motion? Motion carries.
Okay, May 19th, special council meeting.
Moved by Councillor Caxero and Councillor Snively. Any questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
Okay, C, May 25th, special council meeting.
Moved by Councillor Bjorkman, supported by Councillor Caxero. Any questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
Okay, now we have our public presentations. Our first one is Kirk Vivier from Essex Taxi.
Mr. Vivier, thank you, sir.
Got the clock.
What's that?
Got the clock.
Robin's got the clock.
Yes, sir. And if you just push the little purple button where it says talk, it'll turn the mic on.
Okay, first of all, I'd like to thank the mayor and the council for seeing you this evening. Okay. The thing I've got is my taxi business, okay? Right, we're struggling to stay above water with the higher insurance, okay? I've been 3 years working with Donna Hunter trying to get the prices into like a fair range. Like, Mr. Mayor, one question. Did you just cut the impost fees 50% in town?
The impost fees?
Yeah, the development charges.
Yes, sir.
And why was that done?
Well, you got me doing it. When you push this, leave it off, leave it on, and then we can hear what you're saying. You want to know why we did it? Who's the, well, I guess I can tell you. So, council as a whole figured if we cut our development fees, there's a chance of us building more homes in our municipality.
Very, very good. I'd like to promote Essex. Good job, guys. I'd like to put my hands together for you guys. Now we need to do a little bit for Essex businesses. As Councillor Vokes said, quote, unquote, downtown is deplorable. We need to cut a few fees. We got to promote some new business so when we do get new houses here, people have shops to go shopping, right? The seniors can go uptown and look around, okay? We need some business development also. The problem, Mr. Mayor, is in 2011, I paid $1,700 to license my taxi here in the town of Essex when it cost $78 to do the same licensing in the town of Lakeshore. Now, that's 2,100% higher. Okay, I state for the record, just a second, I got a folder here. Excuse me. Okay, I'm all set then? Okay, good. Now, I have all the supporting documents. I did my own research, okay, on this. Okay, now, compared to the town of Essex, okay, it's 230% higher for me to license my taxi here to Amherstburg, okay? Compared to Leamington, it's 350% higher, Mr. Mayor. Compared to Lakeshore, this is a good one here, it's 450% higher than Lakeshore, okay? It's 190% higher than the highest priced municipality is LaSalle. It's 190% higher than that. I started this business, I lost money for 3 years, and now the town's threatening to shut me down. I've been fined. Mr. Mayor, look at this. This is just bylaws pertaining to the taxi company. Okay? Here's the bylaws for Leamington. Do you see the difference? This is like a document it says that the building inspector can enter my house anytime that he wishes. Okay? Without notice. I've got permission from town to run a home-based business from the clerk, Jerry Merriam. Okay? And I don't think nobody should be given permission like this. Okay? Now, what can we do to keep Essex Taxi going? Do you care about your seniors here? Do we want to promote drinking and driving? Or are we going to charge me 320% higher than the highest priced municipality around? What can we do about this? I have all the supporting documents in front of me. If you'd have to, like to take a look at them, they're right from the township offices. Donna Hunter said she paid a consultant to do a survey. I don't know where this consultant did the survey, but it surely wasn't in Essex County.
Is that it, Kurt?
Yeah.
Okay. First of all, I'd like to go to Mrs. Hunter to ask her if she has any comments, seeing how you're using her name a few times, and then Councillor Snively.
Through you, Your Worship, if I may. The study that Mr. Bevier is referring to is actually our comprehensive study of fees, and it wasn't a survey. It was actually a calculation of what it costs for us to provide the licensing service. So I just want to clarify that. And basically, when those fees were brought forward to council, that was recommended that they be reduced by one half rather than the full cost recovery. So that's what was approved by council.
Thank you very much. Councillor Snively?
Yes, through you, Your Worship. This is to Donna. Have we researched what the other municipalities charge? He has figures here. Have we researched that and found out what the other municipalities charge for licensing?
Through you, Your Worship, yes, I did. I did. I have a full comparison of the county.
Is he correct with his figures?
I have copies here if you'd like to see them.
Okay.
I'm not sure where, like, I'm not sure about the percentages. I know in some cases we are higher, but not in all cases.
Well, I'm going to voice my opinion here on this issue. If we are that much higher on licensing, I think we better take a good long look at that.
Here, here.
Sir,
excuse me.
Sir, you already spoke.
Okay.
I just want to get to the issue here. Thank you. If he has figures and they are correct, I would like to research it and see what the other municipalities charge. And if he's correct, maybe we better review it again. So, thank you.
Comment, Donna?
Through you, Your Worship. I'm just going to do a few of them here. Our new license for the taxi cabs themselves is $157.50. Kingsville's is $300. Lakeshore's $111. LaSalle's is $2,000. Tecumseh's $500. Leamington is $75. Windsor's is $400. And Chatham-Kent is $85.
Your Honor, she's talking.
Excuse me, Kurt. Yeah. You've had the floor. You said you were finished. We'll give you a chance at the end, okay? So just hang on. Now you can push your button and shut that light off. Shut your purple. Thank you very much, sir. We'll get back to you.
Okay. And our taxi cab driver license is $114.50. Kingsville's $25. Lakeshore's $22. LaSalle's $200. $75 for Leamington. That's a 2-year license. $110 for Windsor and $45 for Chatham-Kent. And we did look at these, in answer to Councillor Snively's request, we did look at these fees very closely. We did a cost recovery analysis of these fees. And even at that, when we re-adopted full cost recovery for all our miscellaneous fees for this particular fee, we reduced it by 50%.
Okay, thank you, Donna. Mr. Phillips, and then Councillor Vokes.
Thank you, through you, Your Worship. Effectively, what the treasurer has just indicated was what I wanted to state is that council instructed administration to undertake a study of all of our fees and charges. That was done in 2013, I think, and there was adoption in last year of a number or a series of new fees and charges. Of those, this one was one that was heavily analyzed and scrutinized by the previous council and reduced by that 50% mark at that point in time. So it has, to me, been tested already.
Thank you. Councillor Vokes.
Thank you, Worship. So if I could, Donna, in terms of Mr. Vivier, his fee per month is how much to the town?
Through you, Your Worship, the fee, it's not a monthly fee, it's an annual fee. Well, and the annual fee for a new license for the taxi cabs, $157.50, and for the drivers, $114.50.
And that's annually?
Correct.
$167?
$157.50 for the taxi.
Yeah.
And $114.50 for the driver.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Bondi.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Vivier, for coming forward, and actually, it's nice to get to meet you. I remember very clearly in the last term of council when we had this presentation in terms of cost recovery, and the council of the day did debate this, and we talked about reducing the taxi cab licenses to 50%. So I remember, it's same thing we've done with development fees. We've reduced them by 50%. So right now, at the $157, we have a 50% reduction. So we are meeting our taxi cabs in the community. We are meeting them halfway. I really think it's fair. It's by no means cost recovery. I would love to see all of our user rates cost recovery, but it's not something that's always feasible. The reason why we did reduce it from around $300 to $157 is the council of the day, which I still agree with the decision, and there's, our deputy mayor, our mayor, Councillor Vokes, there's still four of us here. The council of the day reduced the fees in order to encourage more licensing of taxi cabs in our community because we understand they're an essential service. No, I don't want more people drinking and driving. I appreciate what you do. Being a bartender, I appreciate you probably more than anybody up here. I understand that, you're providing a driving service to those that are vulnerable populations or intoxicated populations. But right now, I cannot, without further study, justify reducing it further. But thank you for coming.
Deputy Mayor Malash.
Thank you, through Your Worship. I too thank Mr. Vivier for coming to address council on his concerns. And I agree with Councillor Bondi. Last year, when we took a look at this, I roughly think it's about $25 a month per cab that it would cost per year. Like, so $25 a month, but it's around, it was around $300 a year or less. So under $25 a month. And we thought, originally it was $50, closer to the $50 a month. And we thought we would split it in half. But that other $25 right now goes back to all the taxpayers in the community because there's an actual cost for ensuring that you have proper licenses and that you have your police clearances and that you, and so on. And our bylaw enforcement officer has to visit to make sure that the taxi cabs are in safe order and all those kind of good things to make sure residents are safe. And I'm not saying that you, sir, would be unsafe. But if we're going to treat one taxi cab one way, we have to do them all the same way. And we're setting a precedent here that says we're going to make sure that all our taxi cabs are safe. The drivers that are driving the taxi cabs are people who should be driving taxi cabs. We wouldn't want anybody disappearing all of a sudden because they didn't have a proper taxi cab driver. And I'm not saying that you don't. I'm just saying that in instances where this could happen, we're making sure that as a town, that we're not liable for anything that may happen at, you know, in the taxi cab business. So we've got pretty good rules laid out here and pretty good policy that our administration wrote out, and that's the reason why you see such a thick document, is because we're trying to cross all the T's and dot all the I's to make sure that everything's done the way it should be. Other towns may not have as many rules and regulations, but I think over a period of time, you'll see every municipality move in that direction, because lawsuits these days are just incredible. People sue over the smallest thing, and we want to be sure that we're covering all points to try and make sure that these kind of things don't happen for you as well as for the town and any taxi cab service that comes into the town. So with that being said, we're already putting half of the cost of the administration of having a taxi cab service in town. We're already putting 50% of that back on the taxpayers' back in order that we can make it easier for the taxi cab service to survive in the community and still have some profit. So $25 a month, I'm going to suggest that I think it's fair, you know, between yourself, the owner, and the taxi cab driver, to share that $25 cost per month. And hopefully it's not going to make it such a difference, $25 a month, that it would push you out of business for each taxi cab driver. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, sir. Okay, Mr. Vivier.
Okay, to clarify the facts of Donna Hunter, okay, there's two different licensing systems in Amherstburg. Existing business owners get renewed at a different price, okay? If I could just approach the bench here with some facts, just have to look at the highlighted areas. It shows you the price. And we're 190% higher than the highest priced municipality. 450% higher, I state for the record, 450% higher than Lakeshore. Okay? We're 350% higher than Leamington. Okay? Now, can you explain how the administration can operate so much more efficiently than this council? How can it cost 230% more to do things when we're only 16 miles away from Amherstburg? We're only 20 miles from Leamington. We're actually touching Lakeshore. We're actually almost in LaSalle, okay? 190%. Why is the administration cost that much more here? You're saying about administration cost? Why would it cost 190? I paid $1,700 one year in 2011 for the same thing. I state for the record, $1,700 for the same license I could have got for $77 in Lakeshore. Now, that's 2,100%. I state for the record, why should I carry on business in Essex when I can go to Lakeshore and operate at 450% cost reduction? Why?
I have Councillor Bundy.
This is facts here. Oh.
Councillor Bundy.
I would just like to move receipt of the presentation. I am quite comfortable with the $157 we collect for taxi fees. And my thoughts in terms of Essex and how we are with our cost recovery and our fees, I think we're kind of ahead of the curb in terms of other local municipalities that are reviewing their fee structure. So I'm quite comfortable leaving it the way it is receiving the presentation.
Motion to receive, supported by Councillor Caxero. And I'll just tell Mr. Vivier, to me, we run Essex. This group decides on how we're going to vote on things. Administration gives us recommendations. Like Mrs. Hunter has stated to you, we had an outside firm come in a couple years ago and tell us exactly what it cost for a marriage certificate. Might have been $35, and we only charged $25. It went up to $35, might have gone to $40. Cost recovery. The previous council said, we're not losing money. We're not taking it out of the taxpayers' pocket, which we have done, the last council, by cutting your fees in half, which we did big time with development fees. Those are taxpayers' dollars we're using. We're putting them in your pocket, and now the other people's pockets. Taking them out of one pocket, putting it in the other. You know, and now you want us to do it again. Like Councilor Bondi has stated, that's the end of it. Thank you very much for your presentation.
I create jobs here.
Sir, you're all done.
Wait a minute, Mr.
We have a motion on the floor, sir, and no one can talk except council members. Okay? To the question. To the motion? Council vote? Okay.
Thank you. Look, I don't want to open a can of worms, but Mr. Vivier, I don't want to hear about percentages and 450% and 375%. I don't want to hear all that. Not that it don't mean nothing to me. I just don't want to hear it. When you tell me it's $1,700...
Council votes, never mind. We're talking to the motion. We have a motion on the floor, and that's all we're going to... We're not, no more. I know, but you want to have a discussion with the gentleman.
I don't want to have a discussion.
Let's hear what he has to say, Tout.
Listen.
I don't...
Last time, I can have you removed, you know. I'll call a recess if you can't be quiet, sir.
Thank you. Can you just call order? I don't want to argue. I don't want to fight. I just want a simple question asked, just for clarity reasons. The $1,700 you talk about you pay in Essex, in relationship to the $7,700 you pay, don't talk, please, in Lakeshore.
$77, Randy.
$77 in Lakeshore?
Yeah.
$1,700 in Essex.
Yes.
That's what I just said.
Excuse me. We have a motion on the floor, and if I hear one more word from you, there will be a recess. You're talking to this gentleman, Randy, and he's wanting to answer you. He doesn't know he cannot speak. You do. Okay? Okay.
I don't know why you're
here. Here we go.
I really don't. I'm trying to figure all that out, but Mr. Vivier, I'll sidebar with you after. I don't want that going on. I'm trying to harness that, and I'm trying to do my best at it. And I'm starting to understand why I go off. And for this purpose, I'll talk to you on sidebar after, because I want to know that difference and what it means before we just simply receive it. And I won't support receiving it, for the record, just so you know. It's crazy.
Anything else to the motion? All in favor of the motion? Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you very much, sir. Mr. Gorski, welcome, sir.
Essex Taxi is going to be closed too. You got another closed business in town, out. I'm closing Essex Taxi. Anybody want to know? I state for the record, Essex Foxy is now closed. Another business shutting down thanks to our council. Have a good day.
Welcome, gentlemen.
Good evening. So we have a couple of inconsistencies on this drainage report. Bellcraft Beach, when we first decided to offer some of our land for sale to help alleviate the storm drain problem that Bellcraft Beach is having. After the number of meetings we had in October, and before that was August, before that was March, I see that this report, which I just received 3 weeks ago, was date stamped by Gerard Rood in December, just this past year. We didn't get any mailing. So the problem we've got is that there's inconsistencies in the reports. There's inconsistency in this mailing getting to our address. Impact, Dan and I checked today, Dan Boudreau and I checked today, Dan's office. They have two addresses mixed up with Impact. They've got half of our home address in Harrow, and the other half our Old Castle address, where most of Land Holdings' corporate business goes to. And they've mixed the two addresses together. So right now, the information is going to 5400 Walker Road, which is somewhere between the 5th and 6th concession. Someone's been taking the mail. We haven't been getting it. We don't know where it is. So this is the first we've seen this report, and we weren't able to make this past meeting on this drainage report. I mean, I can get to a list of inconsistencies if we want to do that this evening, or I'd like to sit down with Gerard Rood and go over it to make sure that, you know, we're both on the same page, that we both know that there's a right thing and a wrong thing to do with this report, and there's a lot of detail we need to go over. Like I said, I just seen this for the first time 3 weeks ago when I picked it up at the office, at the town office.
We have Mr. Phillips.
Just for the clarity, can you explain again, please, the address that you are citing, 5400?
Sure. So my dad passed away in 2010. He used to get all the mailing, and his address was 6110 Walker Road, Harrow. That was where it used to go. Since he's passing, we moved everything to our corporate office in Old Castle. The address there is 5400 Walker Road, Old Castle, NOR1LO. MPAC has merged those two addresses together, and now it's going to 5400 Walker Road, Harrow. I don't know where that is. We have not been getting anything from the neighbors. I called Steve Rose at MPAC today, and he will straighten it all out after we found out what the problem is.
I have a chronology of events regarding the file on the Belcraft Beach drain. And the information that I have, it would indicate that on February 27th of this year, our clerk, who's not with us this evening, but the clerk, Cheryl Bondi, had received a phone call from Ted Gorski, president of Gorski Land Holdings, who advised that the mailing addresses for rolls 670-029, 670-031, and 670-033, which are included in the drainage report for the proposed works, need to be corrected. Ted advised at that time, he was advised to send the information in writing to the town, to the municipal offices. On February 27th, Ted Gorski did send a letter to the town, to Jillian Lemour, who received it, our tax clerk, advising that the addresses for the three roll numbers listed above, as well all other roll numbers, should be 5400 Walker Road, Old Castle, Ontario, N0R1L0. On March 9th, of this year, a notice of court of revision was mailed to Gorski Land Holdings at 5400 Walker Road, Old Castle, at the above address, at the same address. And on March 30th, the court of revision was held at the Municipal Building Council Chambers, 33 Talbot. And then on April 20th was the last day for appeal of the decision of the court of revision. So I'm sorry, Mr. Gorski, but our records would indicate that the information that you needed to be sent regarding the appeals and regarding the drainage acts were sent to 5400 Walker Road, Old Castle.
Did you get it?
We weren't at that meeting. We didn't get the information. I may have been out of town on that in that time in February, but I wasn't at that meeting.
Councillor Snyder has something.
Through you, Your Worship, I don't know if they received the documents that were mailed to them or not. I can't say yes or no, but I would recommend, you know, before we go any farther, we have to get that, Joe, and you know it, we have to get it fixed. You know that. It's been going on for years at Belcraft Beach, and it's a mess. I'm sure you went down there yesterday or day before. It is absolutely a mess, and it's got to be taken care of. I would highly recommend that to council and through the chair, if the Gorskis could get together with the engineer, and let's see what it's going to take to proceed with this matter, because it has to be corrected. It has to be taken care of. Thank you.
Well, my question would be, if we followed the rules, can we change them? Like, you know, there's time periods and everything else, and I don't know if I should be asking Mr. Rood or Russ or Mr. Nepsey. Mr. Rood. You know, like, it sounds like the town did exactly what they were asked to do, and then, you know, the appeal periods, they go by. I don't know. Mr. Rood, can you help us out here, sir?
Through you, Mr. Mayor. The As far as I am aware, we followed all the proper procedures under the Drainage Act to pass the report and adopt it. It was given final reading, and the appeal period after the final reading of the bylaw was to appeal on the bylaw itself, and that had to be done within 10 days of the passing of the bylaw. Not received any notice that that occurred, so the town basically is in a position to move ahead with construction at this point in time, because there's no further avenues of appeal pursuant to the Drainage Act. The one section of the Act that could possibly come into play is Section 58.4, where the Drainage Act discusses an error in the report. If at any time after the bylaw is passed and before any assessments are levied, a gross error in the report is found, the council of the initiating municipality may, on notice to all persons assessed, apply to the tribunal to correct the error. So that is the one avenue that is still available to council to use. They can make an appeal to the tribunal to remedy a gross error if that's what council finds is the problem with the report at this stage.
Thank you, sir. Councillor Caxero.
Through your worship, just point of clarification, if I heard correctly, we did have the wrong address for Mr. Gorski or Gorski Holdings, but upon getting the proper address, it was in time for him to get indication of the quarter revision, which we did mail out to the proper address, and at that meeting, regardless of the reasoning, he wasn't there to present his case. Is that correct? Thank you.
So sounds like. Recommendation. Deputy Mayor Malage.
Through your worship, I just have a question that I want to ask Mr. Rood. So Mr. Rood, is there an opportunity for the Gorskis to sit down with you? And I'm not even sure if they're looking for any major changes or anything like that, but just give them an opportunity to review with you, and perhaps you can explain as to why certain things are happening the way they are. Or I haven't heard that there's major things that have to change here. Maybe they're just minor points, and unless you've already sat down with the Gorskis. And
through you, Mr. Mayor, I was only made aware of the concern a few days ago. There has not been any opportunity to schedule a meeting with the Gorskis to review that matter. I have no difficulty at all sitting down with the Drainage Superintendent Dan Boudreau and the owners to go through and explain what's in the report and the basis of what was included within the report, and try to address any questions or concerns that they might have that may help alleviate some of the concerns or issues.
And is that possible, sir, without council making an appeal to the tribunal with regards to an error possibly happening?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, I have no difficulty in sitting down and reviewing the details and stuff. We don't need to take the action on the gross error unless it's determined that that actually exists and council wants to pursue that venue to the Drainage Tribunal. Perhaps through the discussions, we can clarify or indicate that we've done a fair job with the report as presented to council, and what council deemed to be a reasonable report for the works, and hopefully avoid further concerns or issues with the project. If we're unable to appease Mr. Gorski, he always has that opportunity to come back to council as a delegation, and you could hear him out and determine whether a gross error may have been incorporated within the report that was passed, and then make the appeal to the tribunal at that point.
Okay, thank you very much, sir, for your willingness to sit with them. I have Councillor Vogtin and Councillor Caxero.
Thank you, Worship. My intent was the same as obviously as Deputy Mayor Malosh's, is to say, how do we get back to the table and understand and get the concerns outstanding answered, as it obviously as it relates to the Gorskys, and I think this, there may be an opportunity here. Something else I want to talk to council, when in terms of drainage, this would suggest that we, even though there could be a cost attached to it, that we start sending out notices in a registered letter, because it obviously, if this was registered, we could prove, or we wouldn't even be here tonight. And I don't know what the cost of doing that in terms to a regular mail out, but 9 times out of 10 drainage concerns are a little sensitive in terms of people's property and up to flooding concerns and you name it. So we should be looking at sending letters to in terms of registered. Just some food for thought. I think it would be to our advantage at the end of the day.
Thank you, sir. Councillor Caxero and Councillor Bondi.
Through your worship, I am not opposed to Mr. Rood and Dan sitting down with the Gorskys and explaining the scope of the work. I am absolutely opposed to this putting any type of a heed on what we were doing there. Based on what I saw yesterday, those people want that work done yesterday. It was absolutely atrocious, Belcraft 1 and 2 yesterday when I drove through there, and that was after the rain had stopped. It had been worse. So if we're going to delay this project, I'm not in favor of it. If they want some dialogue as to getting some clarification with regards to the scope of the work, absolutely in favor of it. That's fine. But I do not want to see this be delayed, not one second.
Thank you, sir. Councillor Bondi.
It's very funny. Councillor Caxero had exactly, I had not opposed and worried about holding up the project. So I echo your sentiments completely. We have all known that we've wanted to do something at Belcraft Beach since I've been on council. So it's a long time coming. And I know there's members of the audience here that are residents of Belcraft Beach. And I've seen numerous pictures on Facebook that this project needs to go through, and it's long overdue. So it's very logical for the Gorskys to have a meeting with our drainage and our engineer. At the same time, I cannot support this if it does hold up the project, because we have to get this project through. And in terms of Councillor Vokes with his registered mail, I agree that that's something that an option that we should look at. I think we should set a limit, a dollar limit. You know, if drainage works are going to cost more than $300, then a registered letter is appropriate. But there's a lot of drainage works that are $20. Maybe we don't need a registered letter for that. But I think that's a good topic we need to discuss. And I don't know, when the time is appropriate, I'll move receipt of the presentation, and as long as it doesn't hold up the project.
Thank you, Councillor Snively.
Through you, your chair, I agree 100% with Councillor Bondi and Caxero. This is a project, I know the Gorskys very, very well, and I don't think they're going to hold up the project either. If it is going to hold up the project, through you, Joe and Ted, I wouldn't support it. It can hold up the project. It can't, because what I seen yesterday was unbelievable. So as long as we can work together and not hold up the project, I'm all in favor of you meeting with our engineer. Thank you.
So you were seeking a meeting, and looks like you got it, Joe. All you got to do is set up the time with these two gentlemen over here, and we're moving. Okay, any final comments?
Thank you very much. We're looking to not hold up this project either, because we understand the importance of it down that area. What we're looking to do is just make some minor changes on it, get some clarification on where these numbers are in, make some changes, some of the berms, sizes, that kind of thing, but nothing's going to hold it up. It's all detail work. It's up to Mr. Root how much we're going to hold it up, I guess, right? We can get to a meeting and get down to the bottom of this pretty fast, but it's two sides of the story. There's us and Mr. Rood, so let's hope that it isn't held up at the other end.
Okay, thank you very much. Gerard, comment? No? Yep.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. Section 58.4 allows the work to proceed. Because you've adopted the report, we've gone through the appeal period that was available to quash the bylaw, and that didn't occur. So upon instruction from council, we can move ahead with preparing the tender documents and get the project tendered and moved ahead. Section 58.4 can still apply anytime up until the bill goes out for the final assessment on the project. So there's going to be several months available for dealing with any questions or concerns that might still arise after our meeting with the owners.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. I'll go to Councillor Bondi. Motion received. By Councillor Snively. Any questions? All in favor of the motion? Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Our next is 8A, Community Services, report number 2015-017, regarding the Colchester Harbor operations.
Councillor Caxero.
I will move. There was two options to this report. I'm going to move to remain status quo at the time. I think we're a little bit ahead of the game here putting this out for RFP. I realize it's only to get, or the intention is to get some maybe tire kickers and see what they'd propose. But I think there's some other work that needs to be done prior to that happening by our municipality. So I would be moving, keeping the status quo at the harbor.
Comment, Councillor Bondi.
I also I support the motion. I guess I have a few questions for administration. I was kind of blindsided, and I'm sure numerous members of our council were this morning when AM 800 said help wanted. And now on AM 800, it has a posting saying Essex Council is looking for new harbor management. Essex Council has not passed that motion yet. Be more applicable if we passed it tonight, and that was the headline tomorrow morning. So it was kind of inappropriate, and I was kind of taken aback, of course. I'm not in favor of option one at all. It's the first step towards privatizing a public harbor. I don't feel there's enough information in this report, and this is my fifth year on council, and I don't remember council at all ever giving direction to go ahead with a report like this. I don't know, maybe I was sleeping for a couple of years, but I doubt it. Our harbor has lacked years and years of investment through our municipality. It is just now coming back together. We have a new kiosk, we have a new, you know, gas tank, we have some new docks. Like, we're just now getting it to the point where it's looking really good. And if you look at our harbor, of course it's not cost recovery. An arena is not cost recovery. A soccer field is not cost recovery. Tell me what thing in the municipality is cost recovery, because I don't know. So I guess my question to administration is where did this idea come from? Because I certainly have a whole bunch of other ideas that we could be spending administration's time on that have at least some council direction and some council sanction. If administration is looking for make work projects, we could certainly start looking at the 2016 budget and, you know, seeing if we could get our budgets passed a little bit sooner. So I'm just actually flabbergasted at this report, its timing. We have so many irons in the fire and so many projects on the go that I can't believe that we would even think about adding this one. We can't even write a lease to operate a harbor restaurant, and now we're going to think about writing a lease for somebody to privatize and run our harbor? My God, it just floors me. It's just wanting to know where the direction of this report came from, because it certainly wasn't from me.
I don't know if I should let Mr. Sweet first or me. Go ahead, Dunn.
Through your worship. During budget deliberations for 2015, it was raised at that time to look at options for operating the harbor and to do a report back. So in my previous report in May, when we talked about discussions regarding the harbor restaurant, is also a report to come back by June 1st on the harbor operation. And as Councillor Cax said, there is two options there, status quo or to look at other options.
Okay. Mr. Phillips, then I have Mr. Snively and Mr. Malosh.
Thank you. Through you, Your Worship. Further to the councillor's questions, there were discussions during the budget preparation. There was also discussions following an RFP on the restaurant itself. And those discussions were with the only proponent that offered any kind of a solution to it. It wasn't hard and fast in terms of how they would move that solution forward. But as you do recall, council may recall that we'd had discussions with St. Clair College, and the proposal of operating more than simply the restaurant portion is something that they are interested in as part of their business proposal. So we are not in a position to negotiate. We are in a position to put out an RFP to allow us to have further discussions on that. We can't sole source this. And at this point in time, the college has indicated a desire to enter into discussions on both the restaurant portion and perhaps other business operations of it, not including the ownership of the facility, but looking at it as from an entrepreneurial perspective and for a training prospect. That was the only group that we've had discussions with at this point in time. So we have been instructed, and it wasn't as though we were dreaming this up. This is an opportunity, and for us to be able to put it together, to put it to bed for next spring, we have to get working on it now.
Thank you, sir. Councillor Snively.
Through you, Your Worship, the only thing that concerns me here is, again, I was floored too this morning. I didn't think it was going to be on 800 AM radio. I was in my truck at 6 o'clock. I almost fell out the door. But anyways, I helped Wanted sign out at the harbor. After we spent all that money on the harbor, and I have to agree with Councillor Bondi, the harbor looks terrific, and it does. I just don't want to see us go ahead and privatize that or have somebody take over that harbor. We know what happened at Ranta. We know all you have to do is drive along the river through LaSalle and take a look at all the marinas there and look at the shape of them. And that'll answer the question right there. If anybody wants to take a ride and look at the condition of these marinas, I do not want to see Colchester privatized. And when I was out and this discussion come up with a lot of residents out there, and we know the harbor is losing money. We're well aware of that. But go and tell a ratepayer that we're talking about having somebody take it over and see the response you get. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Deputy Mayor Malosh.
Yes, through you, Your Worship. Unfortunate that the headline on the radio this morning was that we want to lay out a help sign, because that's not really the whole proposal. And I am in favor of moving forward on this proposal. I do recall back when St. Clair College, and we had other persons that were looking at reinitiating the restaurant. I do recall that there was a brief conversation about St. Clair College perhaps wanting to do more than just the restaurant itself. It would be part, could be part and parcel of the whole deal. But if you go to page 4 of the report, we have operating deficits on the harbor. I myself personally would like to see ways of trying to get the operational deficit down. This could perhaps be one way of doing it. We're not going to be sure until we put an RFP out to try and figure that out. I don't think the town of Essex is looking to, we don't have, we have a lot of summer help at the harbor, but very few full-time. I don't think the position of the town is to move away from those persons that, one person that I'm thinking of in particular is an awesome employee. And I'm sure that we have positions within the town of Essex right now that we're still trying to fill and have work done. I mean, there's not a lack of work. It's not like as if we're trying to get rid of people. So that's not the whole point of this. The whole point of it is to try and partner with somebody that can help us share in these costs and at the same time get something out of the whole operation itself. So if it's an education, part of a person's education to work at the dock, if it's a part of a person's education to work in the restaurant, there's some benefit to this other partner as well. For us, it's offering a service to our community and to those patrons that come into our community as visitors. We're not looking at this and trying to say we don't want to have anything to do with the harbor. All we're doing is looking at this and saying, is there a better way to operate the harbor than what we are doing it currently, and at a better, and at a better cost to the taxpayer? Because, I mean, going back to 2012, 2013, we had an operating loss of $200,000. That's a lot of bucks. That's 2% in property tax increases. So if there's a way that we can look at it, still offer the same service. We're not saying that whoever the partner is going to operate. They're just going to have an operational lease. They're not going to have the ownership of the harbor. We'll still have the lease with the federal government. The town of Essex would still have the lease with the federal government. We would still be responsible for capital outlays. Perhaps. I'm not sure what we would fit into the agreement. But obviously, we're going to try and get as much out of it as possible, and hopefully we've got a partner that wants to come on board and makes it maybe even better than what it is now. So I'm not opposed to this. We're not trying to do anything dastardly here. I think it's something that administration is, in my opinion, this is a good thing that we're looking at this to try and figure out a way that maybe we can partner with somebody and bring down some costs. So I'm in favor of this motion. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, sir. I have Councillor Caxero and then Councillor Bjorkman.
Through your worship, I believe we're missing the point here. There's a difference between the restaurant and the harbor itself. The restaurant is not the business that the municipality should be in. A harbor potentially is. So I believe we need to kind of make that difference. We should be pursuing the ownership of the harbor through the federal government. I don't see that there's been enough emphasis put on that. I know we've had some phone calls made to them. I know there isn't a whole lot of money there, but we need to pursue that. When I was on council 10 years ago, we went to Ottawa. We met with the ministry. Maybe we need to do that again. We need to come up with a creative way of getting them to buy into our business plan. This is a gateway to our municipality for our tourism. And I might add that it's a gateway that includes Ohio and Michigan waters, which is the largest concentration of pleasure boats in the world. So why would we not want to maintain control of that? I understand it's not to sell it, but I'm not comfortable with somebody else managing that. To me, that's going to be important going forward in our tourism industry. We certainly, I don't think, are going to start putting out RFPs to get people to manage our arenas. That would be the same thing. If our arenas are losing money, is that what we're going to do? We're going to revert to allowing somebody to manage our arenas? I doubt it. Okay, we need to put more effort into our business plan. Obviously, what we're doing there hasn't worked very well. That doesn't mean we can't do a better job. I don't think that's been done yet. Maybe we can come up with a better business model and we can lose less money or maybe even break even. So, in my opinion, we need to stay the status quo, we need to bring back the Harbor Steering Committee, and we need to meet with the federal government seriously and make a pitch to acquire the harbor, as we should have continued to do from 10 years ago when I was on council. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Councillor Bjorkman.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'm looking at this as a great opportunity, as a fresh eyes development. We want to put the RFP out there so that people can come into our harbor, have a look at it, make proposals to it. We don't have to choose a winner on an RFP. It was one of the things we discussed as we were talking about the restaurant. We can do the same thing with the harbor. There are professionals out there who this is their business, this is what they do. Why can't we invite some of them in, have a look at our harbor, give us a proposal that when we look at it, maybe we find out, you know, partnering is a better idea. And maybe we partner for 5 years or a limited time, we get ourselves up to speed, we find out some things that help us, and from that point on, we can go further. This isn't forever. This is getting an RFP to bring in professionals who do this. Also, working with St. Clair College, that opportunity to put students to work, put them to work in our community, They come out there every day. They spend their summers out there. Maybe they end up deciding, you know what? This is somewhere I want to live. This is a great area. So there's a lot of opportunity to partner. And I keep going back to what Deputy Mayor Malosh. I always lose that the word deputy. What you were saying as far as this is an opportunity for us to learn. And I just can't see any downside to putting out the RFP and having that that fresh eyes look in on our project. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Anyone else? I just have a couple comments here. Councillor Caxero mentioned meeting with the federal government. I do believe Councillor Snively and Deputy Mayor Malosh met with our MP, Jeff Watson, you know, in the last few months, you know, with regards to this issue. I think they gave us a verbal report as to what was going on there. It didn't look like it was a very good, soon-to-happen affair, you know, at the time because of finances again. But there's, and Councillor Bondi, in her little speech there, made a comment about we don't even know how to make a lease up. And I hope she wasn't referring to our present day administration in that little spiel, because that was done long before our CAO, Mr. Phillips, was here. And the gentleman that did do that happened years ago. He's not with us any longer. So I took a little offense to the comment that had to do with the lease that was written in the past. So I don't know. I think we need to be a little sharper at what we're going to say. Like, I see a lot of guys are writing it down here. Maybe I should too, because I don't always say maybe what I should say, but some guys write it down and pretty well read word for word, which probably makes sense for me to do it lots of times too. So, but anyways, that's all I have to say. If anyone else will get a motion. Okay. Councillor Caxero.
Through your worship, point of clarification, I did mention the federal government, but I mentioned the ministry. I don't believe Jeff Watson has a portfolio, so meeting with Jeff Watson is not meeting with the ministry, so I just want to make sure that's clear.
Okay, thank you, sir. Okay, we have a motion to receive and support, or Councillor Caxero? You made the motion.
I already made a motion to keep the status quo.
We had a second, yep. Right. We had a seconder. Okay, everyone ready for the question?
Can I record a vote?
Yes, sure.
Councillor Bondi?
Support.
Councillor Vokes?
Support.
Councillor Dortman?
Opposed.
Councillor Caxero?
Support.
Councillor Snively?
Support.
Deputy Mayor Malosh?
Opposed.
And Mayor McDermott?
Opposed.
So we have 4 in support, 3 opposed.
Motion carries.
Motion carries.
Okay. Status quo. Oh.
Okay, you have. Okay, our next report is.
Your worship.
Oh. Councillor Caxero.
If I might, just on that same note, I really would like us to seriously consider developing a Harbor Steering Committee. It consisted of 1 council member and a lay member before, and the clerk and the Parks and Rec director. I really think we should seriously consider that if we're going to move this file forward.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, item number B. Community Services Report number 2015-018 regarding the sports mural location.
Deputy Mayor Malosh?
Support the recommendation.
And supported by Councillor Snively. Any questions? All in favor of the motion? Motion carries.
C, Corporate Services Report number Clerk 2015-7 regarding the procedural bylaw amendment.
Councillor Caxero.
Motion to receive and enact bylaw.
Supported by Councilor Bondi. Any questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
Item D, Community Services Report Number 2015-19 regarding the Canada 150 Community Infrastructure Program Grant Application.
Moved by Councilor Volk, supported by Councilor Caxero. With a question, Councilor Caxero.
Through your worship, I just want to mention, I love this idea. I now see why my veiled attempt to direct these funds or these potential funds at extending the trail may be very much pale to this idea. I think it's great. I think it fits along with the funding. I wasn't aware of what the criteria was, and in seeing that, I hope we're very successful in getting some money, and I think we can really do some nice work down there in Jackson Park.
All in favor of the motion? Motion carries.
Sorry. Correspondence 9A, Jim Wilson, MPP, Simcoe Gray, interim leader of the official opposition regarding current funding formula for Ontario's rural schools.
Councilor Bonney moves, supported by Councilor Snively.
Mr. Mayor, can we also send a thank you letter? A thank you letter to Mr. Wilson for advocating on our behalf.
Supported by Councilor Bjorkman. All in favor of the motion? Motion carries. Thank you.
Item B from Mark Bueller of 147 Eiler Avenue in Essex, looking for relief from bylaw number 690, the Town of Essex Noise Bylaw.
Moved by Councilor Volk, supported by Councilor Bjorkman. Any questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
Item C, Town of St. Mary's, Southwestern Ontario Transportation Alliance, Network Southwest Action Plan.
Moved by Councilor Volk, supported by Councilor Caxero. Any questions? With a question, Councilor Caxero.
Through your worship, I'm just wondering if that motion includes supporting their direction. Okay.
Your recommendation, Councilor Bondi, was?
Well, to support the direction.
Direction, okay. What support of direction? Their direction. All in favor? Motion carries.
Item D from the Town of Aurora, community mailboxes.
Motion received by Councilor Bondi, Councilor Bjorkman, with question from Councilor Bondi.
Perhaps we could have some direction to our administration. I've been talking with several supporters of Canada Post, and some municipalities have passed bylaws where when community mailboxes go up, a planner has to be on site. So I'm wondering if we can investigate that option, because if Canada Post decides to come into certain areas of our municipality and they want to put up a community mailbox, I think that our town should have a representative at the table. So I just like to give, I don't know if we need a motion, but I know the city of Hamilton has done it, and if some of our staff could maybe do some research and come back with other options on different bylaws about what other municipalities are doing in terms of planning around these community post mailboxes.
Recommendation to administration. Chris, would you?
Through your worship, I know moving forward with new developments and new subdivisions, the location of that mailbox is presented through the planning committee as far as planners are on board, the infrastructure of the roads and whatnot. So that's definitely looked at moving forward. I don't think we've come across a case where they've removed the location or removed
door-to-door service and place those mailboxes and what input we have, but we definitely can take a look into that.
Thank you. All in favor of the motion? Motion carries.
Item E, Windsor-Essex County Environment Committee, April 30th, 2015 meeting minutes.
Moved by Councilor Voigt, supported by Councilor Caxero. Any questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
Okay, we're now at 10, the committee meeting minutes. And A is Fun Fest Committee meeting from May 21st, 2015.
Moved by Councilor Caxero, supported by Councilor Voigt. Any question? All in favor? Motion carries.
Item B, Coann Park Committee meeting, March 11th, 2015.
Deputy Mayor Milosh moves, supported by Councilor Voigt. Any question? All in favor? Motion carries.
C, Coann Park Committee meeting, April 8th, 2015.
Mayor Milosh moves, supported by Councilor Bjorkman. Any questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
We're now at 11 bylaws, and A is bylaw number 1422, being a bylaw to regulate the rate of speed on Snake Lane in the town of Essex.
Support. By Councilor Snively, supported by Councilor Caxero and Councilor Snively.
Yes, to Chris, when would the signs, how soon can we get those signs up?
Through your worship, depending on the crew schedule this week, as soon as possible. So I'll let, I've already emailed the operations manager that the bylaw passed, and he can put that into the schedule. So if it's more than what would be considered, I guess, normal, so anywhere past the next week, I'll advise council.
One further question. When I asked you at the intersection of Given and Snake Lane, where the road goes into the subdivision there, just it would be south of that before the curve. Is there a possibility to have a sign there, or is that too close?
Through your worship, because Given technically is in an urban center, it's 50 without being signed. So that change in, comes at entering Snake Lane, which is as you turn south, so there will be signs on that straightaway heading south towards that curve.
Okay, great. I because I had a resident ask me that. Thank you.
All in favor? Motion carries.
B, bylaw number 1424, being a bylaw to confirm the proceedings of the June 1st, 2015 regular meeting of the Council of the Town of Essex.
Moved by Councilor Caxero, supported by Councilor Bondi. Any questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
Okay, we're now at new business, and that would be Councilor Bondi regarding the Christmas lights in Harrow Center.
Councilor Bondi.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Before we head into our 2016 budget deliberations or even planning, rather, I think it's important that council have or come to a consensus on what we want to do on street lighting throughout our municipality. As we know, last year, Harrow Center, we were in a big kerfuffle because we just didn't get street lighting until mid-December, I believe. So I, as the chamber rep, I thought it'd be best to bring it forward in June rather than October or November. And the council, the chamber rather, is asking that that we have lights in Harrow Center, and we can use the existing lights. And you know, I think Dan Boudreau's team, or a public works, sorry, I'm not sure who, but they did a great job of fixing the lights that we have, and we were able to get them up. But if we could have them up, perhaps earlier in November, so that there's not a panic in December. And if council can have a discussion about what we want to see in downtown lighting, whether it's the BIA doing Essex Center's lights and volunteers doing McGregor and Colchester, or and it's the chamber doing Harrow Center's lights and the cost coming out of beautification funds, I just think council needs to have a plan going forward. Whether it's uniform and we pick up that cost and we have to add $100,000 to our 2016 budget, or whether we keep going the status quo by patching and not having uniform lights. I'd like to have that discussion now so I can go back to the chamber and so they can be prepared too. And if they have to provide their own lights for the next 10 years and they know that they have to provide their own lights. But every year it gets ahead of us, and then next thing you know, it's the end of November and the residents are freaking out. So I just want to open the window for discussion.
Thank you. Councilor Caicedo.
Through your worship. I had mentioned it through budget deliberations that I felt uniform lights throughout the municipality would be a good idea. Obviously, that's a decision of council, because I think if we go to uniform lights, we would probably have to foot the bill for it. I don't think it's something we should necessarily do 2016. I would hate to see any of the lights being used currently tossed out, irregardless of whether they work or not, just to go to uniform lights. I would suggest we come up with a plan maybe in 2016, and going forward, if it's council's wishes or if council supports the idea of going to uniform lights at some point throughout the municipality, I would suggest we put that plan into place, and as lights need to be replaced, we do so, and we make that uniform across the municipality over a number of years. That would be my opinion on the situation.
Thank you, sir. Deputy Mayor Milosh.
Thank you, through your worship. If we were to go uniform again, as Councillor Caicedo was suggesting, I think that it all of a sudden it would be our burden to make sure that everybody has the same lights. I'm not in favor of the town picking up the tab on Christmas lights. I've pulled a few other communities who right now have multiple centers. For instance, Lakeshore does not go out and buy the Christmas lights for their communities. It's the same with Kingsville. They don't go out and buy the lights for all of the communities. So right now, I think Councillor Bondi mentioned $100,000, but I think it's going to be a lot more than $100,000 over a period of time. And then once the lights need replacement and so on, I think it's better left to the businesses to come up with a creative plan on how they're going to come up with their Christmas lights. It also gives them an opportunity to be unique. We've always pushed for uniqueness between the different communities that we have. The tourism and the wine industry that we have out in Colchester and Harrow makes them unique. And I think the street lighting that they have right now reflects that kind of an atmosphere, whereas it may be a little bit different in Essex Center. And if McGregor were to someday have Christmas lights in their hamlet, I'm sure the lights there would be somewhat different than what they would have in Harrow or Colchester or, for that matter, Essex Center. So I don't think, I'm not a believer that we should be paying for the Christmas lights. If there's an avenue for us to help them with installing, I would say that we should add that to our budget for sure, to try and see if, you know, and I don't even know if we have the manpower to be able to do it. It would have to be something that way that we would have to ensure that we actually have the manpower to do it. So that's my opinion. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, sir. Councilor Bjorkman.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just in response to that, I know as far as Essex Center, having been involved with the BIA for a number of years, their lighting, the lighting that we have in Essex Center has grown over 4 years of purchasing. We couldn't have it all at once. So 1 year, you know, we spent $20,000, and the next year we spent $20,000, and the young lady up in the audience probably knows exactly how much we spent, more than I do. But it's considerable amount of money, and it took time. We had to put that aside, make sure it was a budget, and it was there. I still believe that all four of our centers should have Christmas. We shouldn't drive into one of our centers and there's just no lights. The BIA is a different format than the chamber is. We've had that discussion. You can't compare the two because they don't have the resources the same. But if they want to have the same lights, the same accoutrements and things, well, maybe you have to change your structure and have the businesses pony up. I believe we're responsible to have something in the towns, but as far as helping it, I would say, you know, we can help out, but there has to be a lot of input from the downtown, because that's really who benefits from it.
Yes, sir. Councilor Volk.
I think when we start splitting hairs in terms of somehow finding a way to financially support festivities such as Christmas, we've really made a wrong turn in the road. And I say that with the utmost respect to everybody involved. I really would like to know, though, fairly, what do other municipalities do in terms of lighting at Christmas, other, whatever the season may be, and how do they handle it? Maybe we could benchmark what they're doing, and the answer may not be as complicated as we think if we could see what they're doing. So I don't know if Doug could take the lead on that in terms of having some dialogue with other communities, what they're doing. I don't know whoever's assignment that. Well, we're talking about lights, right? Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize to you, Chris. You're right. You are an engineer, aren't you? I thought you were an engineer. Now you're like a light guy. Make your mind up. If we could, Chris, I do apologize to you. If we could have those discussions with other municipalities and benchmark what they're doing, that may help us.
Sir, Councilor Bonnie.
Thank you, Councilor Volk. I think that's a good start. So if we compare locally what other towns are doing, and then we come back, I guess what I'm looking for is something that I can go to the public and say, you know, we don't do this, or we do this, and this is the reason why. And no, Amherstburg doesn't do this, and Kingsville doesn't do this, you know, because it's very heated being a councillor in Harrow Center when there's no Christmas lights and other towns do. If the chamber has to provide 100% of the cost of the lights, then I go to the chamber and I say, you have to provide 100% of the cost of the lights. And I have a solid, concrete answer. And it makes sense, like Councillor Bjorkman has said, it's taken the BIA numerous years to get to the state that they're at with their lights. And I'm sure if I said to the chamber, you know, we can use our beautification money, we can do some fundraising, and it might take 3 or 4 years to get where we want to be, but at least I have an answer for them. An answer for this year, for 2016, I was hoping that council could agree on, you know, at least putting something up in Harrow Center. And I know the chamber can't use volunteers to climb up the light poles. That's, you know, if we could, we probably wouldn't be having this conversation. So if we could even use the beautification money to have the town or Elk put up the lights, then that would solve our problem for 2015. But I cannot go through another Christmas like I went through last year. I think I dodged a couple eggs on the street when I was walking downtown Harrow, and I don't want to have that again. So, you know, we understand that we give the urban centers beautification money for things like lights and other things, but we just need to have an answer for the chamber, for the BIA, just a plan. So I agree, Councillor Volks, if we can provide that direction to have somewhat of a quasi-report about what other towns do with their Christmas lights. You know, I know when I drive down the Vollmer Center in LaSalle, you see every single tree is lit up. I have a hard time believing that's the BIA in LaSalle. Maybe it is, but I don't know. I don't know. So it'd be nice to know. So we have that answer.
Thank you.
Item B is Councillor Volks. Two items here. Consideration for an amendment to the town zoning bylaw, number 1037 Kimball Drive.
Councillor Volks.
Thank you. I just want to have some brief discussions with council in terms of mileage remuneration, because when we passed the bylaw, I think we left a significant element out of it in terms of what we passed, because I got to reflect on it. Was the last meeting that Councillor Snively had talked about the deplorable condition at the auto wreckers in Harrow, where there was environmental concerns, and even tonight we talked about the harbor. Prior to this being passed, as councillors, we were in a position we would receive mileage remuneration for that, because it fit the bylaw at the time, and we changed it now. So now when we want to go out and do our council business on a daily basis, we have no cost recovery on that as a councillor. But everybody else, no matter who it is, administration or whoever, gets it. And in simplicity, if Councillor Melosh wanted to go check one of his roads, Mr. Caxero, Mr. Snively wanted to come in to Essex check something, there's no cost recovery for him. But in terms of the way this is written, everything's in there but that. I can go to, people can go to a conference and I'm not going to get into that because that's an extremely sensitive issue for me. But people can go to conferences and they will get paid from the time they leave their door to the time they get back to their door. If I simply go to Harrow to check on a yard that is affecting our environment, I can't get no recovery for that. And all I'm asking is that we add an addendum to that bylaw, or however we do it, to put that in there in terms of council being recovered.
I just have a question, because I'm just hearing what's going on here for the first time. So, if I may ask Donna, if this gentleman goes out to Harrow with regards to whatever that was, that, you know, okay, something that's going on at the harbor, he doesn't get mileage for that? Is that what he's saying?
Through your worship, he would if it was a body of council, it was a meeting, or there was, you know, the council had decided as a whole that they were going to meet and look at something at the harbor. But for individual council members to go and see a ratepayer or go look at something in the municipality on their own without any requirement to do that, no, there's no coverage. That is, we're getting confused here between a bylaw and council mileage. The bylaw was to declare one-third of council's remuneration tax-free, and what that is for and what it is to cover is expenses incurred by council that are incidental to their position as elected official, which is going out and seeing ratepayers or going out and seeing things that they want to see. What the policy or the my report to council dealt with in terms of council mileage at the request of Councillor Bondi was what kinds of things, and compared us to other municipalities in the county. So basically what would be covered was meetings as a body of council, which are your regular, your special, your closed meetings. Committee meetings where the council member is a member of the committee. Meetings required under the Drainage Act and conferences, seminars, and training. And events where a member of council is representing the town. And what is not covered is members going to visit a ratepayer to go look at a site or whatever the case may be.
Thank you. You okay, Randy? You okay. Councillor Snively?
Yeah, just clarify this. I'm going to go back to Snake Lane when the roads were just, they were a mess with the quicksand out there. I had all the residents, quite a few residents want to meet with me out there to show me. And as an elected official, I think it is my duty to go out there and meet with these people. And nobody here, I don't think, is trying to make money off of mileage. But when I get in my truck and I drive, you know, there, it's wear and tear on my truck, it's mileage on my truck, and it's a cost to me. So I agree with you when just to go out and meet with somebody, but when there's an issue, an important issue like this, and I go out and meet with them, okay, and I'm told that I can't put down 17 kilometers in mileage, I think it's wrong. I really do. I'm an elected official. I'm asked to do a job, okay, and like I say, I'm not looking to make money off of this, but I want to be reimbursed for what I use in my tank, plain and simple. This issue out here, like Councillor Vogt says, every councillor should go out there west of Harrell and take a look at that wrecking yard that's occurring out there. They should see it for themselves. So that's my opinion. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Councillor Vogt?
They're not, so thank you, Councillor Bjorkman. Either council's going to support it or not, so does it have to be a motion put forward to support the changing of the bylaw? What's the direction? Could Donna help us out, or Russ, or somebody give us direction as how that motion would read, if that's...
We would have to change the bylaw.
Through you, Your Worship, it is not a bylaw. It is a report that went to council with two recommendations, and I read the second recommendation, the first being to receive the report. The bylaw is to do with a one-third tax-free council income.
Okay, so then, with all that being said, I'm going to put a motion forward looking for support to add mileage reimbursed to council for council business travel.
Okay, we have a motion on the table. Yep, we need a second there as soon as she gets that written down.
We would second the motion with discussion.
Okay, Councillor Snively supports. Okay. Discussion, Councillor Bonney, Councillor Snively, and Councillor Caxero.
Thank you. I apologize for causing this can of worms when I asked for this report on mileage, and there are reasons I asked for this report on mileage, and it was totally more so to do with the last term of council than the present term of council. I guess my question is if we're opening the floodgates on mileage, we might as well throw away this report because anything goes. And I just, my question is, where do you draw the line? You know, I still go back in my head, what's applicable? What's not applicable, right? I think one solution we could have is possibly having more meetings in McGregor Center, perhaps maybe having a meeting somehow in Colchester Center, having some of our off meetings in Harrow Center to bring our council members into various wards. That's always been an issue, and we've tried to have that, but maybe we need to have more, you know, strategic planning. I know we do in McGregor Center. Sounds like we need to get our councillors out and about in our municipality somehow. My question again is, where do you draw the line, right? We know we've had in the past council members that have had $700 mileage checks. And if you don't know it, then you haven't read the check register. And I'm thinking about... No, it's not all conferences. You can see the report on how much they have on mileage. Maybe we need to go back. I don't know. It's not you. Not you. And I think you have a very valid point. Councillor Vokes doesn't go on conferences. And sometimes, I believe, you can have... five meetings down the road and learn just as much in that five meetings as you can going to a conference. But sometimes it works the other way around. I just don't know where you draw the line, right? And one third of our income is tax-free. And if I'm, you know, in Harrow and I want to go to the other end of my ward and it's 3 kilometers, do I mark that down? Like now it becomes blurry again for me. And I think we all maybe have different moral compasses. So maybe Henry's writing down, you know, everything he does in his car, and maybe Bobby's, you know, writing. So it's just, you know, if I go to a parade in McGregor, do I write that down? You know, I wouldn't go to that parade if I wasn't on council, but I don't feel like I should voluntarily want to go on to that parade because I am on council. I feel it's an honor to represent this town, and I feel my attendance at events is voluntary and not always mandatory. I think if it's mandatory, you should get paid, and I think if it's voluntary, then everything becomes gray again for me. I don't care what we agree on. Let's just agree on something. But if you all are marking down parades, I am too. I'm the single mom here. So.
Okay, I hope you're finished. If you aren't, go ahead, because we have a motion on the floor, and you're going to speak to it once. They got just about everyone here. So I have Councillor Snively, Councillor Caxero, Councillor Bjorkman, and Councillor Vogt. So do it all in one time.
Through you, Chair. I don't think anybody here is going to take advantage of that. I agree with Councillor Bondi, like parades and stuff like that. But I'm going to go back to if some of the residents require a meeting on I'll go back to Given Road or Snake Lane again, an issue like that, or if we have an issue regarding what's happening west of Harrow and what was happening on Drummond Side Road. I don't think we're talking a lot of mileage here, to be honest with you, but I think if, like when we had the unveiling of the monument in Essex here, I come to that. I didn't put that down for mileage. That's, you know, that's volunteer. I come here, and that's part of being a counselor, and that's part of being, you know, to represent the town. But when it comes to meeting with a group of people that has a very, very valid concern, and they don't want to talk to administration, they want to talk to their counselor. And when you go out there and meet with them, I think that should be allowed mileage, plain and simple. And like, I don't think anybody sitting here is going to take advantage of it. That's my point. Thank you.
Councillor Caxero.
Through your worship, to Donna Hunter, Is there any monetary implication to us having one-third of our wages tax exempt?
Not sure what you're asking me.
Does it cost the municipality anything?
No, okay. Absolutely not.
So, I mean, I guess, and where I was going with that was, I was going to ask if the motion was going to include then rescinding the fact that we have a third of our wages tax-free, because that's the purpose of it. I guess that's the extension that the town is trying to make to compensate for some of that, because we would obviously have to pay taxes on that. That would cost us money. I don't know what that implication is. I guess we could figure that out if that isn't enough. But again, it means nothing to the town financially, so it's not as though they gain where we will have to pay out for whatever that mileage is. I'm not opposed to it. I mean, I guess the issue is just everybody being reasonable. And I think the group here is reasonable, I hope. So I'm not necessarily opposed to that being done if council's wishes are to follow through with this.
Okay, thank you, sir. Councillor Bjorkman.
Thank you, Your Worship. I want to make the same point that Councillor Caxero was going at there. The reason for the report was to identify what our mileage, I don't know the right word, mileage accumulated funds and what weren't. And the ones that are in the gray area, one-third of our income is not taxed. That gives me $100 a month. I'm not going to spend $100 a month in gas going around and meeting with people in the town. So what we asked for in this report is what we got. And if it was taxed, that'd be another $100 that I'd be missing that I would look to recoup. But that's how that's paying for that mileage. As far as I'm concerned, the report we got and the status quo where we're at is the right thing.
Thank you, sir. Councillor Vokes.
If I could, I'm going to take a minute to clear up the tax exemption third of it, because people are Donna's right in what she's saying. But if I have my own business and I had working out of my basement, I could write that off. I could write that portion of my business off. So that money would come directly to me. Like when I run my council business, I'm using my home. That's the purpose of it. It has nothing to do with mileage, because mileage is a separate entity on cost recovery. It doesn't have anything to do with mileage, the one-third tax rebate. Nothing. It's nowhere in there. It has everything to do right up to including the clothes on your back or the pen you're using tonight. Office supplies, clothing, suits, shoes, home, telephone, heat, hydro. That's the third. That's what that talks about. I just got a simple question. If Chris or Doug or anybody from administration jumped in their car tomorrow and went and looked at the harbor and come back, can they submit the mileage to do that? Yeah, I just...
Through you, Your Worship, if it's legitimate business,
yep.
And there is a requirement to go there for a legitimate business, yes, they would.
So now Randy Vokes wants to go look at the environmental disaster out there. I don't get nothing. I don't get a nickel. But anybody in administration can go out tomorrow, and Chris could get a concern over something out of the public works yard by an employee, go out and look at it, and he submits and he gets paid. If I get that same grievance come to me, and I go out and look at it, I don't get nothing. So also on that, it's about, look at people. It's about really? It's about applying a little common sense. Nobody wants to financially take advantage of nothing. It's like Councillor Snively said. When he goes to Snake Lane, he puts gas in his vehicle, wear and tear in his pickup, he gets no recovery. If Chris does that in his pickup, he gets full recovery. Where's the balances? We're all on business.
I like to believe we are. And that's all I'm asking. I don't want to make it, I don't want to make it a flavor of the day for a media feeding frenzy. It's a simple little request. And I, and by the way, I've seen a couple of counselors who support it. And I just, I don't know what the... Hang on, there's another meeting going on. So I don't know why this is such an issue. I really don't. And I'll just look at it, I'll leave it at that. So that it was a simple little request. And I know that the request from other of my colleagues on council put simplicity to it too. And now it's been a 20-minute discussion.
If I may, Randy, just like you asked what the difference was, the only difference I can see is we are exempted a third of our salary for taxes, and these people aren't. That's the only difference I can see. You know, we both put gas in our cars and everything else. That's according to the report where Donna's coming from. That's all I
want to
say.
I get all that, and I don't want to start finger pointing and act, even though it's already been done, and accusations. It's a simple little request. Either we're going to support it or we're not. And I'm going to end it at that.
Okay, Deputy Mayor Malosh.
Thank you, through you, Your Worship. Well, a couple of points. I'll give you one, for instance, like Councillor Snively here and other councillors as well have met with different developers to try and enhance the business investment in the community. So right now that wouldn't be included as part of mileage. So if they had to drive to Windsor to meet up with the developer or something like that to try and get them interested in the town of Essex. And some people may say, well, that's, you know, if you want to do that, that's, you're out on your own to do that. But I do believe it's part of being a councillor. And some people may say that it's not, but it is. It's up to council to try and make our town look as attractive as possible. It's up to us to try and bring in potential new developments. And we may not be the one who put the final blessings on it and that, but there's a lot of times where we can make a difference with connections that we have in the community to make sure that, you know, they want to put their dollars here and invest their dollars in our community. So that's one, for instance. One of the other, one thing I want to go back to this one-third tax exempt too. I would say half the weekends in the year, I'm at a fundraiser. I'm buying tickets for pasta dinners, and I don't particularly like pasta. So I'm going to pasta dinners, and Larry, no, that's not nice. He says I do look like I like pasta. But in all honesty, I think the one-third tax exempt is also because I'm hit up for every ticket sale that there is, any raffle that there is in the community, and I never say no. It's the same with donating to different fundraisers that are going on. I can tell you right now, I, you know, all of us here are in tune with that, and that's, I think, where the one-third maybe tax exempt comes in. I never claim anything for office supplies. I never go to the town of Essex and say, give me a bunch of paper or a bunch of ink for my printer or anything like that. You know, it's, there's a lot of things that I say, hey, you know what, I get one-third of my income as tax-free. And really, it's, when you think about it, it's not a lot of money, the one-third tax exempt that you get. I mean, maybe one-third of your income is a lot more money, but the tax that you would pay on that is, it doesn't really come to a whole lot of money. Nothing compared to the amount of money that I can guarantee you that I pay in tickets to go to different fundraisers over the year. And a lot of times I'm buying tickets to these fundraisers and I'm not even going to the fundraiser. It's just because I want to support something that's going on in the community. And I think more or less that's where I vision the whole one-third of your income not being taxed. Maybe not for mileage. Because I think what Councillor Vokes is saying makes sense with, you know, this is a true expense that you're doing. You have no choice. I mean, you could say you're not going to go to a location and view something that's going on in the community. I'm going to give you another, for instance, you know, and not everybody feels the same way as I feel about roads, but there's, I do a lot of touring of roads, and about three or four times a year, I take off in my vehicle when I have a, maybe a Saturday afternoon or an evening, a rare evening where I don't have a meeting, I take off and I'll check it out. Hey, where's the grass being cut at the sides of the roads? How far along are we? Where are the potholes at? I get a lot of calls from residents throughout the community about roads because they know I live in rural Essex. They're interested in having my opinion on what's going on. So I will take off. I will, in the early spring when the frost starts coming out of the ground, I probably put on 100 to 120 clicks on my car to try and figure out where the problem areas are. And if I, you know, I want to see how Public Works is moving along on some of these projects, and I'm out on the roads checking it out all the time. So I understand what other councillors are saying about being there for the things that they think that are important, that they need to be part of in the community. And for the little bit of money that you're going to get for going back and forth to Harrow, it's not a lot of money to say, hey, we appreciate that councillor's effort to go to a location and check out a site. So I'm kind of leaning towards maybe we should be looking at this and providing mileage for those kind of incidences. Thanks, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, sir. Councilor Vokes, you got money.
You have a motion.
Okay, you want to read it again?
So the motion was moved by Councilor Vokes and seconded by Councilor Schneibly that council be reimbursed for mileage for travel to council business.
Ready for the question? Okay, all in favor of the motion? I probably am going to do. Going to oppose? Okay, you got it. There you go.
Councillor Vokes, you had a second item for the amendment to the town zoning bylaw?
Yes, if I could, to Lynn, I've withdrawn that, Lynn, in terms of, or administrative assistant Lynn, in terms of discussing it with council, but I appreciate you recognizing that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Item number three is Councillor Vokes for the discussion of flooding.
Councilor Vokes.
Thank you, Worship. I think everybody knows the position that the town found themselves in yesterday as a result of the flooding. And I want to go on the record, and I want to make it very clear that this town, this council, and this administration, as a result of the flooding concerns that arose last fall, have been looked at, have been trying to deal with it, but I want to clear something up, because I think what I'm coming to find is, as the calls I got, which was 17 of them over the last time period, is that certain people, and I'm not going to say who because I don't think it's fair, because I'm a strong advocate of if you challenge somebody, I think they should be in front of you. And in this particular case, the person's not. But what happened then was we were in an election. And when we were in that election, it was very clear that people going to the doors during that election period were telling people that they or we as a town, and I say they or we as a town, we're going to fix that. We're going to do something about that problem. So even though it was an election ploy to maintain a seat, the message was sent to the people. And the people, I think, are today, now that it's months later, are trying to define why some of those things haven't come to fruition. Because they were fallacy promises on porches, if I get that position. And again, I don't want to say any particular person, but I know it for a fact that there were some fallacies dismissed on doorsteps. And now the people in their pain of flooding are relying on those promises, and they're not happening. But those discussions that took place were never agreed by any council at that time, or agreed by this council this time. But now our feet's being held to the fire, what was being told on the porch. I think that's a big element. And I can tell you this, it's nobody in this room. I guarantee you, it's nobody in this room. But I know for a fact it's somebody who isn't in this room, who is running for election, made some very false promises that people are hanging on to today to see it come to reality, and it's not gonna come to reality. My second concern is this. In terms of what we're doing today, because as a town, I can tell you, Chris Nepsey, our engineer, has worked diligently with the task force committee on initiating processes to arrest the flooding concerns. And I want to make something else very clear. It's been said that council doesn't have any idea what's going on. That's not true either. Chris has put report out after report, and just put one out a couple weeks ago about the current position and what the task force is doing. Chris has a meeting this Thursday with the task force. So we're doing everything we can do in terms of some surface fixes, if you will. The rest of it is, my guess would be, it's a real infrastructure concern. I know there's questions about our lagoon capacities as a secondary resource to take some of that flood waters. That's something maybe the flooding committee could look at. There's a lot of things the flooding committee could look at. But what I'm concerned about is this, and I just want to summarize with this, and I'll end it at this, because I know a lot of people want to talk to this, is my concern is this. What we're doing, and we are doing a lot, is not making it to the doorstep in terms of what administration is doing, what in the direction council's going. And I would hope that, and I know me and Chris have talked to it about it today, but I would like an independent mail out go out to the people from that says the town of Essex on it, endorsed by council, the mayor and council, that says here's where we are currently. Chris has can give you a stack of paperwork this high of initiatives that he's put forward already in terms of trying to arrest this problem. And it's not going to happen overnight, but everything everybody wants us to do today in terms of what happened yesterday, as of right now, we're working on it. We never assumed that another storm would come in such a short time period to put us in such a horrible position. If we would have had that time without that storm yesterday, I know Chris is looking at and having the committee looking at subsidy programs for subsidizing check valves and different initiatives. So I want to tell everybody, whether you agree or disagree, the administration and the Council of the Town of Essex is working on everything we can do to arrest flooding. We're fully aware the City of Windsor has already got the program in place. We're fully aware other municipalities have got things in place. And we're fully aware that we're getting it in place. So, you know, everybody's seen the email I got tonight where the lady sent me the video of her basement flooded. We get all that. There's nobody sitting here in this bar in front of you tonight, doesn't feel your pain, doesn't understand your anguish, and clearly understands we need to do something. The question is what and when, and we're working on that. So I'll open it up for discussions with the balance of council.
Mr. Nepsey.
Thank you, Your Worship. Yeah, I just want to follow up on Councillor Vokes's statements as far as what we're doing and give council kind of a summary. I know I have been sending those summaries along to the flooding committee advisory. I copy council on what's been happening and what's taking place. But I just want to summarize again. I think it's important here at this point. I think right off the bat, it's important. And we talked about the last flood, and I know it's a numbers thing, but you know, the average rainfall for southwestern Ontario, for Windsor, from 1981 to 2010 is 3.5 inches a month. A month. in June. In May, I think it's 3.6 inches. I haven't got the data yet, but in the people I've talked to, were anywhere from 3.5 to 4.5 inches of rain yesterday. In Essex Center, and particular down in Colchester, the Colchester South area. So again, that's in one day, we got our monthly average for the last 20 years, 30 years. So some of the things that we've been moving forward as the committee and as administration here is first off, we wanted to inspect what we had. So we did a manhole condition assessment of the 500 manholes in Essex Center. I have that here. For the most part, what this says is, what we have is okay. There's a few manholes that we found that are creating some inflow and infiltration. We're actively pursuing fixing those. Upon inspection of these, we found some areas that required further cammering. So we're cammering those suspect areas. We've put in manhole pans. So it's basically a pan that sits under the manhole. In low-lying areas in the road. So when the road does flood, which, as I've talked to you before, we want to flood. That's where we want the water. We want the water contained in the road, that it won't enter into the manholes, into the sanitary manholes. We want it going into the storm sewer system. So we've put in over 100 of those pans in Essex Center. We're budgeting for more pans next year and moving this assessment into other centers as well. So Harrow Center and Colchester Center, where we have the sanitary sewer system. I know Amherstburg is currently doing their similar assessment in McGregor, because the sanitary sewer system is Amherstburg's system in McGregor Center. I know they're working on that. So we've installed 8 flow monitors throughout the town center, monitoring this flow. They're still in place right now, so we did capture last night's rain event through those flow monitors, so that data is going to be very valuable in moving forward. The issue we have is we're collecting all this data and we're putting this model into place. We have to calibrate the model and collect enough data in order to have it do anything for us. So that data collection is destined to go to June. So the end of this month, the end of the data collection, so we have that spring, those spring rains collected in that data, and we'll be able to calibrate that model. What that model will help us go towards is it'll help show us where these pinch points are in town, where the infrastructure we may be able to do some capital investment in an area. We'll look at scenarios and alternatives. You know, I may be able to relocate force mains, change the infrastructure in some areas to create some reprieve or relieve some areas that were experiencing issues. You know, the Isler area, the Kimball area, the Oak Drive and Tully Meadows area. We also can model alternatives, as Councillor Vokes had noted. You know, is there an option of putting in pump stations and whatnot and diverting to the existing lagoon system? Is that an option as a stormwater retention? What that brings into play is, you know, you're adding combined sewer now to what's considered a decommissioned lagoon. So now I'm bringing back the MOE. Now I'm bringing back. Are there operational issues? If I allow the stormwater overflow to go there, is the entire lagoon considered contaminated? Do I have to treat it now? Does it become part of my certificate of approval? Right? So there's all these other issues that go on with that. But the model is key in determining where we're going with that. As Councillor noted, furthermore, you know, the flood committee advisory, we've met several times. I think we're on our fourth meeting coming up. It's tough, you know, the machine is slow. These are volunteers and I appreciate their time and effort, and they've really helped, I think, spearhead where we want to go, especially with the subsidy programs and you know, some information and whatnot. So, you know, last council meeting, council approved me going ahead into looking at subsidy programs. You know, I needed your approval in order to look at something that may cost the town money. So every one of the members on that committee reviewed, and some councillors, reviewed a subsidy program in a different area. So we're trying to take, you know, some of the pros and cons from these different subsidy programs and mash them into one that works for the town of Essex. I think in light of the flooding, maybe we can fast track at least a portion of that subsidy program, you know, as far as maybe just the check water valves. We can look at expanding it into cammering and storm sewer works, but, you know, the sanitary check water valve is something that we could probably spearhead and put together a plan relatively quickly. So that's something that that we're looking at doing as well. We also, sorry, I'm just checking my notes here. We also finalized a flood survey, which is going to be utilized to collect that data. I saw, as I noted in that first meeting, the more information we have, the better. So for people to call in, again, I know the desk staff is inundated with calls, and I appreciate their help, but they're logging those names and numbers, and it might lead to something that it might be a new issue or a new finding or whatnot that might help us, you know, discover what's going on. So that's vital as well. I think I need to do a better job on the education and the information session, or end of it. And I need to involve our communications manager and get more stuff on that website. And that's something on my end that I've been working on the hard stuff and the engineering type things and the infrastructure and those analysis. I need to do a better job working on that softer side. And I think that will help alleviate some of the concerns that the residents have as far as what we're doing. I want to put that page together, and I have it in my mind that, you know, we'll have that flood advisory page. Who are the members? What are we doing? Here are our minutes, right? This is what we're doing. This is what's happening. So on my end, that's something that I will push to do on the next several weeks, is get more information on our website, more information on our Facebook pages as far as what we're doing and where we're moving with this. But the hard, potential mitigation measures as far as those grand infrastructure changes, they have to wait for that. Unfortunately, that takes time. And we are working on it, but that model is coming, and that will help us, you know, see what will work. Because there's, you know, for me to say we can put in, you know, four bigger pumps at the sanitary plant and treat the sanitary system as a combined sewer system, I don't know that necessarily that's going to be the, you know, that's going to help. So I need something to say and come to you and say, look, I've got some data, I've got some modeling here. Yes, spending these millions or these hundreds of thousand dollars in this area will help relieve this area. So, you know, I need to come to you with that whole picture, and unfortunately, that's not here now, but it's definitely coming. So, I guess that's it for me.
Councilor Texero.
Through your worship, certainly I think the work that's being done is excellent. It needed to be done. It was definitely pushed by residents in Ward 1, the only thing I'd like to see going forward, and I know it was discussed a little bit at the flood task force meetings, I think we need to be inclusive at some point of the whole municipality, because as we saw yesterday, certainly Ward 1 is affected, but Ward 2 was affected, Ward 3 was affected, Ward 4 was affected. So, and I'm not suggesting that it needs to be immediately, because I know the direction was kind of ward specific, but definitely the issue, there are drainage issues throughout the municipality, and I would just like to see that we at some point bring on the rest of the municipality so that we don't leave anybody behind.
Mr. Nepsey.
Thank you for that, Councillor. I think that's an excellent point, and that's something that's been discussed by several councillors in non-Ward 1 centers, is that although this flood subsidy advisory committee is Essex heavy right now, a lot of the solutions and a lot that's coming out of it is for the entire town. So the subsidy program is going to be for the entire town. The review of our bylaws is for the good of the entire town. The we're looking at already, including in next year's budget, the same assessments in Harrow Center and Colchester Center. So, like Councillor noted, although it's Essex heavy right now, it definitely is moving to help the entire municipality, and what we get out of this will benefit everybody. But
thank you, sir. Councillor Vokes.
Thank you, Worship. I think the intentions, as Chris is suggesting, is even though it may be Ward 1 concentrated, we can benchmark what we're doing in Ward 1 and apply the same application in terms of other areas that are feeling the flooding. I couldn't help but notice, I see a couple gentlemen out in the crowd who seemed, I don't know if you're here for flooding concerns, and if I could, gentlemen, and I certainly, if they took it upon themselves to come here to hear the concerns, because it wasn't on the agenda, and I certainly didn't, I don't know either one of those gentlemen, and I haven't spoke to anybody about talking about it tonight. I would assume they come on their own will to hopes we would be discussing this. So with that being said, I would look for support to hear from them and hear what their concerns may be as a result of them coming here tonight, hoping they could speak with us.
Vote by Councilor Vogt, supported by Councilor Caxero. Okay, all in favor of the motion.
If I could, for the record, could we get your names and addresses?
We'll get that if they're here for the drainage problems. Is that what you're here for, gentlemen? Okay.
Yeah. We're here for the flooding on Eiler. Like, it's the storm sewer.
We need your name and address, please.
Rick Housen, 308 Eiler.
And Carl Grimontpre, 311 Eiler.
Like, the storm sewers, the rain comes, and it's getting worse every rain. Like, backup valves, you want us to put backup valves on our storms? Like, on my drain coming in from the storm sewer? Like, the water was going so slow, the storm sewers overflowed, the water didn't, the piston, like, didn't go away, it just stayed there. Like, why isn't the water leaving our streets?
The storm sewer is stagnant, it does not flow. Take and say that the road is flooded, no, it doesn't flood. You should see the backyards, yes.
Our backyards are flooded, the road, like, the storm sewers are full, the water's not moving. We want to know why the water don't move on our street.
The sump pump in my house filled in 30 seconds. Do you want to know how much of a pain?
Everybody's got a pump.
Okay, one at a time, and if you're going to ask a question,
okay,
could you get... just a sec. If you're going to ask a question, let Mr. Nepsey answer it, and we'll let you have all your questions, but you're both talking at the same time. I'm having a hard time following you.
No,
okay?
Hey, thank you.
Okay?
All right.
Okay.
It's all directed at Mr. Nepsey. You say that you have all these plans and these schematics and that, okay? Have you been familiar with the town of Essex in the past 40 years? Are you familiar with it?
You want me to answer that?
Yes.
Go ahead, Chris.
Obviously, not for the last 40 years, but I have staff that have been here 28 years.
Okay. I'm a resident of 45 years of this town. I've played in these sewers that you're talking about. I know the storm sewer system, okay? We've never had water issues in this town like we do the past year, okay? For me to babysit a sump pump for 9 hours that fills in 30 seconds, there is something wrong. My neighbors had over a foot of water in their basement. They've got video of it coming up from the floor drains. Okay? This is serious problems. Okay? Randy Vokes, you said you had 17 phone calls. Okay? It happened 9 months ago. It's not the storm of 50 years. It rained. There's a big difference. It's a thunder shower and we're flooding. Have anybody sent a camera down there in 9 months? Are the things broken with the construction? Something break? Tell me, please, you have sent a camera down in 9 months. Can you answer that, please?
In the sanitary or the storm, sir?
Storm.
Storm.
In the storm. This focus has been on the sanitary. The bulk of the flooding on Eiler in the last storm was sanitary related, as was the rest of the town. So they are definitely related as far as storm and sanitary. Can I ask the proponent a question? Is the Are the streets still flooded now?
No.
So the issue that the storm sewers are functioning, just not at a rate to handle that much water. As is the case with a lot of the streets in town and even down in the Colchester South. I mean, the fields were flooding, the roads were overflowed, But I went out there this morning, and there are ditches on 50 that are dry. The water is gone.
On Isler, half the storm, the storm sewer backed up into almost every house, I would say, on that street. Everybody had to watch their water coming in on Isler from Maline down to the bypass. That section, there's something wrong. You shouldn't get storm sewer water backing up in almost everybody's house. There's got a problem there, and somebody's got to look into it.
Mr. Nepsey, and then Randy.
I met with the consultant this morning. I went there first thing this morning. We noted some areas in addition that we wanted a camera. What I can do is I will add Isler. We had Talbot. I believe we had Isler. I want to confirm that we had Isler, but if we hadn't, I'll add it to the list of things to get cameraed in the next go.
Thank you, sir. Councilor Vokes.
Thank you, Worship. Just yesterday, and I made note of it when I was driving around and talking to residents and certainly some of the people that had called me and followed up. What I did find in terms of actually road coverage from curb to curb, where you had to slow down going through there, and there is a difference between what we've been looking at and what we've seen yesterday. But I know for a fact, because I was there, was Kimball Drive was flooded from curb to curb and significant distance on the road. All of these, Isler was flooded, Queensway was flooded, Kingsway was flooded, Victoria was flooded, and the entrance into the trailer park was flooded. And when I say flooded, I mean, you know, it was relatively significant, where you had to slow your vehicle down going through it. So them are the roads I come across that had significant flooding to them. And when I looked at those areas, that's the areas where I got most of the calls from the people who were having complaints. So, and again, but gentlemen, I can tell you, we aren't discarding any of your concerns. I don't want you walking out of here tonight, and I would expect you to be disgruntled. If I wasn't sitting in this chair, I'd be sitting in that empty chair with you. I guarantee you that. But I can tell you, as an elected representative to you, we are doing everything we can do to help you in your pain of this. And I just want you, to know that we're not discarding, nor will we discard your concerns. We're writing them down, we're listing it, and we're understanding it. We truly are. The next question is, when you leave here tonight, what are we going to do about it? And the jury's out on that one at this place and time.
9 months ago, we flooded. That was the storm of 50 years. It rained. There's a difference. You haven't sent the camera down in 9 months? What have you done physically other than looking at these proposals and scenarios?
If I could answer that.
They've already been answered.
But we have
those questions have been answered, Councilor Vokes. I'd just like Mr. Phillips to has something that he'd like to say. Thanks.
Thank you, through you, Your Worship. Chris and I were discussing earlier today the amounts of rainfall. I just want to go on record as saying that the measurement that I received from the airport at Windsor Airport was that in a 27-hour period there were 74.6 millimeters, excuse me, of rain that fell. A couple of our people here, when we came into the meeting tonight, we were talking about the amount of rainfall. My own rain gauge measured over 110 millimeters. I live on Fairview. I think one of the other counselors was indicating close to 5 inches in his yard. And that's in a 24-hour period, from starting at about 2 o'clock on Saturday, running through till about 5 o'clock or so on Sunday. So it's not a regular. What Chris said earlier, what Mr. Nepsey said earlier, is that the average received for this area in the month of May is somewhere between 60 to 70 millimeters. We received over 75 to 100 millimeters in a 24-hour period between Saturday and Sunday.
Yes, I agree with that. But it's an ongoing factor now. It's 9 months. These people don't have insurance now either. The insurance companies have written them off. There's no water claim damage in a 72-hour period after rain. What are these other families supposed to do?
Can I add to your rain? The whole town did not flood. Just certain areas you say so much rainfall. Well, the rest of the town was able to cope with that rainfall. The storm sewers cope with that rainfall. These areas around, like Mr. Volk said, did not handle that rain. So there's got to be a problem in them areas in the town that you got to look at and find out, is there a broken drain there? Is dirt falling in and it's going through slow? Like these areas that's not moving the water out, there's got to be a problem. The whole town did not flood, just certain areas of our town, and it keeps flooding. This is not sewer water, this is just rainwater we're talking about today. And it come pouring in.
Hey, Mr. Phillips and then Mr. Snively.
Certainly appreciate what you're saying, that it is an area that we're still investigating, and Mr. Nepsi has been doing that work. I think the other thing that we're very aware of is that not all parts of town, not every house on every street gets flooded where there's a problem. I don't believe that everybody on Eiler, a number of homes on Eiler have been hit. We understand that. But
you should go take a drive down Eiler.
I did take a drive down Eiler yesterday during the storm, as Mr. Volks there, Councillor Volks did. I was around town.
If we didn't have pumps.
Sir, he is the floor, okay? You can have it. No. I'll get to you. Thanks.
We are experiencing failures where there's storm sewer coming into some houses. Sanitary has backed up. In the previous storm that you're referring to in August, August 11th of last year, there were a number of properties where it was storm sewer, some were sanitary sewer. Two houses next door to each other have a problem, and then there's three houses that don't have a problem. So these are the things that we're struggling with to understand, and as Chris had earlier said, or as Mr. Nepsi had said earlier, it takes a while for us to generate or to accumulate this data. I believe yesterday's storm is going to tell us a number of good things about flow in terms of our flows, but I don't know that it tells us what an average storm is anymore, and these are abnormal events that we're experiencing. You're very correct. We're experiencing them more and more. Climate change, I'm not an expert in it, but it certainly seems like it's having its bearing on the number and frequency of storms that we're receiving or the intensity that we're receiving. But it is going to take us some period of time to understand all of the data that we've got, as he's committed to, and I'm sure we will add Eiler to that list for Cameron and get some work done on both sides, both on the sanitary and the storm.
Okay, Councillor Snively and then Councillor Volks.
Thank you, through you, Chair. To these gentlemen, we're well aware of what's going on now. And I mean, we could talk about this for hours. We could. I've been through the same situation. And Chris has assured you he's going to come there with the cameras to put down in both them drains and take a look. So just one other thing. During some of these big storms, I got flooded twice. I live on the 4th of Harrell. And I know what you go through. Just to let the public know, there is other backups you can put in your basements, and maybe I'll just share this. I had a company come in and put a backup on my town water system. The pressure runs it. So I've never, ever, ever been flooded since. So just to share that with you. Thank you.
Councilor Volks?
Chris, do we know what other municipalities were subject to in terms of the flooding? Kingsville, Lakeshore, did they feel the same pain we did, or did any of your colleagues talk about that?
Through worship, I had a discussion with several of them. I know Kingsville and Amherstburg experienced some flooding, and Lakeshore as well. There was some areas that were hit there in particular. I was discussing more with the plant operators and the amount of inflow and infiltration at their sewage plants, where they're not bypassing, but basically getting very little treatment and pushing flow right through those sewage plants. So it was definitely a countywide initiative. And I just want to touch on what Councillor Snively, I know I'm segueing to something else, but we are partners with IRCA as well. This council, or the last council, put funds aside to work with IRCA and develop the new curves for the new design. It doesn't help existing residents right now, but moving forward with designing those sewers and how we see what how these storms are coming and that probability of those storms, it'll definitely renew that. So that's something that IRCA is working on right now.
So in continuance, thank you, Chris. Going back to originally why I wanted to talk about this under new business, we heard Chris, obviously, in terms of what the Flooding Task Force Committee is doing and getting the surveys out and getting that information gathered to guide us as to what problems people are suffering. I look at that more as a long-term, not so much a long-term solution, but a solution that sits on the horizon. I want to encourage council, and I'm hoping we would do this, and I want to create work for Chris, but Chris took the time to explain 9 initiatives tonight that we're doing as a council to try to get our arms around this problem. And if people don't take the opportunity to watch YouTube or go download on our town site, they won't see it. And I think when you're downstairs trying to dry your basement out, you don't have time to watch TV. So I really would like to do a separate mail out to the residents in the town that talk about everything we're doing and bring them up to speed as to what we're doing. Because every question I got from those 17 people goes back to last fall. And I talked about the election that hurt us in terms of what we're doing, but to date, and a lot of things were told what we were gonna do. But if I knocked on any given door today, if I knocked on any given door, and when the person come to the door said, do you know what we've done for flooding in this town? I guarantee you just practically everybody other than those who sit on the committee are gonna say, no, I got no idea what you've done. So we talk about communication all the time. If this doesn't support communicating to the residents, I don't know what does. And now we're all gonna say, well, there's a cost to that, you gotta mail it out. There's a cost to everything you do. There's the undefined blips, if you will, that come across your desk that you don't anticipate. And we should be communicating to people in terms of a door mail out and let them know what we're doing. Because we are doing stuff. Stuff is a word, right? But nobody knows what we're doing. Nobody. There's not one person other than these gentlemen coming here tonight with their grievances and having the chance to hear it. If I would ask these two gentlemen before they walk through that doorway, do you know what we've done so far? My guess is either one of them wouldn't have been able to tell me one thing. So I'm just asking that, and what we're going to be doing moving forward in terms of the areas of concern, such as theirs. And we need to get that memo out to people. And I'm certainly not going to rely on that young man in the pale blue shirt up there to do it for us. I'm not. I think we owe it to the residents to send something out to them that says, here's what we're doing.
Thank you, sir. Deputy Mayor Malosh and Councilor Caxero.
Through you, Your Worship. If we, and I'm not saying that we shouldn't have a mail out, if we do have a mail out, it should only be urban residents. Yeah. The plan that we're working on is really not a rural Essex plan. Chris is shaking his head like maybe that's not true, but I'd argue with him that it is. It's more urban related with in the ground stormwater rather than ditches and sewage hookups to houses rather than septic tanks. So that's kind of where I'm going. I would think it would be more of an insult if you sent it out to rural residents. They'd wonder why you're sending it to them. But with that said, I just want to point out to Councillor Caxero was asking about rolling out drainage solutions to different parts of the community, and I just wanted to mention that I have been working with Chris and Dan Boudreau on different solutions to the McGregor issue, particularly with Sucker Creek. We are trying to move forward, and in the very near future there will be a meeting with the residents of that area to try and come up with a solution. That Sucker Creek area has been an issue for many, many years. I was a kid growing up in McGregor, right on the corner of where the two major creeks meet in McGregor, and I can tell you that from the time that I was 10 years old, I can remember being flooded and days not being able to go to school because Walker Road was flooded and all the properties around that area. So they've since dredged it and made it deeper and all those kind of good things, but whatever they've done in the past has not been sufficient to be able to handle the amount of water that flows through that area when there's a significant rainfall. So we're working on that, and we've got a couple of drains that we've got issues with in the town that have been worked on over the last little while. I was out in McGregor, and of course, you know, at the when the water peaked in McGregor, there's no way you're going to get away without some flooding. So of course, I've had calls from residents, and again, Chris's hands are a little bit tied. His department's hands are a little bit tied because of the fact that the sewage system in McGregor, the sanitary sewage system, is handled by Amherstburg, regardless of whether you live on the Amherstburg side of the street or the Essex side of the street. And you know, we're hopeful that in the very near future they'll come forward with this report that they have on what's going on with that system. And I know that they're trying to move forward on it. They want to make things right there. So, and I think that we will have a solution in the near future. So I just wanted to offer that because I know there other councillors may be wondering, you know, what's going on with other wards. I know with Belcraft out in Colchester South, there was a severe problem with flooding there as well. And but that is something that council's been taking care of, and also through the advice of our drainage supervisor and our public works department and Chris's department again. So there are other things that are going on other than this committee here from Essex Center that is working on issues here that maybe can get carried over to other urban centers, I believe. But at the same time, we're working on other issues through other different avenues. So I don't want anybody to think that we're not, you know, in the viewing audience here that thinks that we're only focusing on Ward 1 here. Thanks.
Okay. Gentlemen.
Thank you. All right. I understand everything that you're going through here, but the bottom line is water's still backing up. You voted in that you're being paid mileage tonight. I'm sure my neighbor would like to see you face to face and you explain to her why she's got water in the basement a second time. Okay? 308 Eiler, it's right next door to me. And you better bring your boxing gloves. Okay? Now, on the upside, I grew up in this town. I've ridden my bike through these storm sewers. Okay? I've been a resident of this town 45 years, and this is appalling to see the level that it's fallen. Okay? We've never had issues like this. I've grown up on Eiler. I moved off for 3 years, and I've moved back. We've never had issues like this in the past. All these new constructions in town all have the eave troughs tied into the storm drains. Why is that part of the building code? Dump it onto their lawns like it should be. That puts the burden on the system. It's common sense.
Yes, sir.
I just want to thank everybody and for what you're doing.
Thank you very much. If Councilor Cattell?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, it's a notice of motion, if I may, once we're done new business with regards to an earlier issue. That's all.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Vokes?
Yeah, thank you, Worship. I'm going to put a motion for it, and obviously I'll be looking for support. It's a little Ward 1 focus, but it's certainly a good start. But before I go do that, sir, I got to tell you, your little comment about mileage and looking people in the face, I talk to more people looking them in the face tomorrow than a church environment would do. So in all due respect to what I had done in terms of mileage and my work and working with the community. And I know you want a rebuttal to that, and we can do it outside after. But with that being said, I'd like to put a motion forward that the Council of the Town of Essex direct administration to do a Ward 1 mail out of the current initiatives to control the flooding concerns.
This motion supported by Councilor Caxero. Donna Hunter.
Through you, Your Worship, can we word that motion a little bit differently and not tie it into definitely a mail-out? Because with the price of postage right now, I'd like to look at other alternatives to an actual mail-out, because every letter we mail out now is a dollar a pop. And looking at those two wards, you're looking at roughly 10,000 people.
It was just one ward, Donna.
You're just talking Ward 1? Okay. Okay, but even still, yeah, we may have different alternatives that'll be less costly than mail-out. We could maybe have students go door-to-door.
Yeah, okay, that's fine. And put in the motion what other alternative measure for delivery could be applied. But I want to get it out as quick as we can.
Okay with Councillor Carroll? Second here.
Thanks, Donna.
Okay. Make sure that we've got the right thing.
That the Council of the Town of Essex instruct the administration to do a Ward 1 mail-out or other alternative measure of delivery, expressing the initiatives concerning the Ward 1 flooding to date.
Councilor Caxero.
Through your worship, I'm not sure if it's too late to throw it in a tax bill, or if the other option, possibly including it in an elk bill. Elk.
Donna?
Through you, your worship, actually, we could put it in the tax bill, but that's not going to go out until the beginning of July, so it's not going to be very timely.
Councilor Vogt?
If I could on that, I don't want it, take it and tuck it in with something else. I want it to be a standalone, right to their door. Here's what we're doing. Here's what we did. Here's what we're doing. Mail out. So it's not confused with anything else, tucked in with something else. It's standalone. There it is. Just like the mail out that went out on Fairview Avenue. Very clear, hand delivered. Not hiding from nothing. Here's what you can expect.
Okay, we're saying, Councillor Snively.
I think, through your chair, Donna had the right idea. Maybe we get a couple students and hand deliver it. I think that'd be the cheapest way to go. Yeah.
Question, is this going out to every resident, every household in Essex Center? Or are we just talking to the flooded ones, no? Everyone, okay.
My motion was Ward 1. They were the most hit, and I'm not discarding anybody else. But they were the most hit.
Okay. Councilor Caxero.
Potentially, maybe this is a job for us councillors to do on a Saturday afternoon.
Why, don't you have anything to do on Saturdays? Oh, I'm kidding.
I certainly would love to help the cause, though. I love to inform people.
I hear you. Ready for the question? All in favor of that motion?
I didn't have a seconder. I need a seconder?
Yes. Councilor Caxero seconded. Sorry. All in favor of that motion? Opposed? Yeah. Motion carried.
Okay, our next item is Councillor Bondi, and it's regarding the Planning Advisory Accommodation Review.
Councillor Bondi.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just got a notice for my daughter's backpack, and I thought it'd be applicable to raise it tonight because there's quite the timeline. So currently right now, the Park Committee has made recommendations to the school board, and I'm not sure if all of council knows what the recommendations are, but I'd like to just abbreviate them for everybody. So there's two scenarios that they presented. They withdrew closing of Harrow High altogether because their rationale was, you know, let's let the school board make that choice. It's not up to us. So scenario number one is maintaining Western as a special education school, implementing community hubs in Amherstburg, Harrow, and Kingsville, maintaining Harrow District High School at its present location until a JK-12 can be built, build a new JK-12 in Kingsville, and maintain General Amherst. So that seems like a win-win to everybody. Scenario two, move Western Secondary School and transition those students to General Amherst High, build a new school in Amherst, implement community hubs in Amherstburg, Kingsville, and in Harrow, establish a JK-12 in Harrow, build a new JK-12 in Kingsville. So other than transitioning the Western students, which to the Western families would be a crisis, no doubt. but that still maintains the Western Secondary School programming, and it still maintains the other three schools. So I would just, you know, this goes to the board, and the meeting is tomorrow night, and I can't go. It's on a Tuesday. I'm working. But I just thought it would be nice to have Essex Council, you know, say, you know, we really like these scenarios. Can you please follow through with either one of these? Because it's a win-win for our municipality. So just looking for council's thoughts, I would love to send a letter tomorrow. I'm not sure if any council member can go tomorrow. Unfortunately, I can't. But just looking for other thoughts here.
And that meeting is?
Tomorrow.
Where? What time? Mr. Phillips?
Yeah, thank you. Through you, Your Worship. I wanted to remind council as well that we have a meeting tomorrow with Aaron Kelly, the Superintendent of Education, I believe, at 1 o'clock at Talbot. And I think that would be an opportune time to advise her what your specific feelings are. If you want to put that forward tonight, then you're together. But then I know there's a couple of you won't be able to make it tomorrow because of work restrictions or that. But if you wanted to still give that authority, then the message is pretty clear tomorrow what your feelings are.
Councilor Kekzero.
Through Your Worship, yeah, we certainly have an opportunity tomorrow to speak to the director. I will also be going tomorrow night to see how things proceed. And I suggest that part of our message should be council, I think, has given clear direction that we're on board for a solution. We just reduced their development charges by 50%. I think that shows some partnership with regards to, because, and I'll say, which I didn't say the other night when I supported reducing the development charges by 50%, a lot of the reason why I supported that was for that very reason, to show the school board that we are a partner. It's a message to them. Because certainly, I don't ignore the fact that our very intelligent administration advised us not to do so, and for some very good reasons. Sometimes you have to make some hard decisions, though. And I think that was one of them, and I think that merits consideration to do that, to actually show that we are in partnership, that we are committed to helping the issue that we have in Harrow Center. So that definitely should be a message, and obviously the message that we've been preaching since December. We are on board for some sort of a form of a community hub, or the idea of a community hub in Harrow. What that looks like, I don't know. We need to have those discussions, and finally, if the meeting doesn't get canceled between today and 1 o'clock tomorrow afternoon, we will have the opportunity to have the school board in front of us, the director, and let's start the dialogue.
Okay. Goodbye.
So perhaps, or I'll make a motion that the town of Essex, our council, supports the scenarios presented by the park committee.
Supported by Councilor Bjorkman. Any Councilor Cactero?
With regards to the two recommendations, I prefer recommendation one, and it's only because recently I've heard from some residents of the county, I'll say. The Catholic School Board has a model as such, similar to that at Villanova, and apparently that model does not do very well. Those students do not have, I guess, the same experience as they do at Western in a standalone school. I see the benefit to possibly having those students in town, the opportunity maybe for after-school jobs and whatnot, but certainly if the programming doesn't work,
I don't know if it's such a good idea. I guess they'll have to do that research. I wasn't part of the park committee. I'm not suggesting what they should or shouldn't bring forward. I think it's okay to support what they're bringing forward, but I would caution in suggestion two however they identify what they're bringing forward. I would just caution that programming or that type of scenario, integrating those students into a regular high school, may have some difficulties.
Councillor Bondy.
I can amend my motion to scenario one, which is maintaining Western Secondary School as a special education school, and then the community hubs and all the other schools.
And that is supported by seconder. Okay with that. She made the motion, now she's just going to say number one. You were the seconder. Yeah, okay. Ending the motion. All in favor? Motion carried. Okay, Councillor Caxero.
I would now have that notice of motion for next meeting, and that is for council to support the idea of bringing back a harbor steering committee to pursue our endeavors of trying to acquire the harbor from the federal government, or exploring that a little more closely.
Okay. Our youth representative, Olivia's still here. Any comment, Olivia? No? Okay. Thanks for sticking it out with us. Motion for adjournment? Councilor Castillo, Councilor Snively. All in favor? Motion carried. Thank you very much. Have a good evening.